both on Facebook and YouTube, viewers have been asking me for a masterclass on finding and writing the chords for hymns, for four-part harmony in the hymn book. So I thought I would take on that project, and tonight we're looking at two hymns, an easy one that's just three chords and a harder one that has a chord change, many chord changes on throughout the song, some on every single note. So we're going to look at the easy one first, and then we're going to look at the hard one. And we're also going to, you're going to hear it. Hi guys, we now are going to outline the steps that you need to find the chords for any hymn in the hymn book. The first thing is you have to learn how to read the music. This just means being able to identify the notes on the lines and spaces in the conventional bass and treble clef, which is the first thing that students of the piano learn. So I could do another video on that if it's required. But assuming that you can actually look and say what note is there, the next step is to fit the notes to the chords. Every chord has, we've been dealing with triads in the last video, so you can think of every chord as consisting of three notes. So you have to match the three notes to the specific chord. And then finally, the last step concerns actually playing the piece. This is the practice part. You have to use chord inversions to smoothly move between the chords of the piece. So these are the three things you're going to have to be able to master to play hymns in this way. Now, both of these hymns that I'm going to do today are in the key of D. One is very simple and the other is very complicated, harmonically speaking. So the simple one, you can see it there, Count Your Blessings, Name Them One by One, a very popular hymn in most hymnals. And as you can see, it only has three major chords, D, A, and G, which are the three principal major chords of the key of D. And it does not even have in any quick, fast chord changes that will make it difficult for you to play. Now, how can we be so sure that these are the only chords and that I have them in the right place? Well, we'll show you in a minute how we know where to put the chords. But in this particular song, notice that the bass line is pretty consistent. Where I have that chord D in the bass clef, the bottom note is D, and then the bottom note switches to A. But where I have the D, A, D at the end of the second line, the bass note is D consistently, even with A. So you can have a D bass note and have an A chord, and you can have an A bass note and a D chord. So you can't only go by the bass line. The bass line gives you a clue, but in hymns where the bass line moves all over the place, you're going to have a much more difficult mechanism of sorting out the chords. I don't look at the bass line at all. What I do is I analyze the chords vertically by assembling the notes, and then from knowledge of all the notes in all the various chords, I can simply automatically write down the chord. This will take you some time to get used to, but you could as well start if you hope to achieve this mastery of being able to write the chords for any hymn. Now, in the key of D, we have principal chords which relate to the principal notes of the scale. So there I've written the scale, which is D, E, F sharp, G, A, B, C sharp, back to D. That is the scale. Now, the second
and third note in the scale are always minor chords. So we have E minor, F sharp, minor. Then we get the G and A, which are the two principal major chords in that key besides D. Then we have another minor chord, and then we have a diminished chord before going back to D. Now this pattern exists throughout all keys. So if you can write a scale, then you can put minor on the second and third and on the sixth and diminished on the seventh. However, be warned, any chord can appear in a hymn. Any chord at all can appear in a hymn. This is the beauty of music. Even though you normally will focus, because it's in a certain key, on the chords of the key, they will be the majority of the chords in the song. And as we saw in the last example, the D, G, and A are all there is in that song. The next one is going to use the E minor, the B minor, and the F sharp minor as well. However, it's also going to pull in D diminished and A minor. So we will have in the next song the presence of both A and A minor. And that's not unusual. That's not at all unusual to pull in chords outside of the principal chords, because it makes for a more rich harmony. And musicians, composers are allowed to do anything. So you can write a song, and to create interest and excitement, you can pull in chords that don't even belong in that key. That is the beauty of music. It's not just a simple thing. This is why computers can't create great symphonies. They simply can't. Because even after you've learned all the rules, there is still that element of, disobedience to the rule that makes for interesting and exciting music. Anyhow, now you can take a look at this more complex piece. This one here is also a very popular hymn. And as you can see, it is "Great is Thy Faithfulness," also there in many hymn books, with a lot of rich harmonies in it. Hence the need for chord changes, more chord changes, and more rapid chord changes than you would have in the other one. Each note, as you can see, may be on a completely different chord, although they're usually related. So that's the full chord thing. Now you will want to know, how did we end up there? So let's move to the next slide and give you some tips. This is a blown up picture of the first two lines. As I said, you circle it vertically so you see what notes are playing at exactly the same time. You write those notes down on the very first one. We have F sharp to the top. Underneath is D. Then we have A, and down in the bass we have another D, which is an octave below. And that is exactly the chord of D, because D, F sharp, and A comprise the notes of a D chord. So you see where I'm going with this. You have to not only be able to read the notes on the staff, but then you have to know that the notes are going to, what notes are in what chords. Now here, the next example is even more interesting, because here we have on the top G, then we have E, and then we have two A's an octave apart in the bass. And I have written an A chord there. But actually, A, G, and E is not an A chord. An A chord is A, C sharp, and E. And there is no C sharp in that stacking. So how can I be so sure that A is the correct chord? And how does G fit in? It turns out that G is the seventh. If you play G along with an A chord, then you have an A seventh. So technically, I should play an A seventh there instead of an A, because of the presence of that G. But I have not yet started to talk to you about four-note chords. And wherever you have a four-note chord, you can substitute a three-note chord, particularly if you're playing along with other people. If you're playing second keys, or you're playing guitars, or you're not the lead carrying the lead melody for some reason, maybe there's a singer or a vocalist that's carrying the lead melody, since the G is on the top, and that is part of the actual melody of the song, you don't really have to play the G. You can play just a plain A chord in place of the A seventh, and it will sound perfectly fine. In most cases, it will sound perfectly fine. Virtually in all cases, it will sound perfectly fine. And the other thing is that the presence of the C sharp does not, an A chord belongs in that spot, okay? So even if the C sharp is not included in the four-part harmony, it's quite okay to put it in. Now, these are things that are not going to be easy for the novice person to understand right away. They're going to be scratching their head. What chord can I find with A, E, and G? And I really can't do much about that. From experience, I know what to do. However, you can play with it after you've got the chords and sing the song along and see if it sounds right. That is always a foolproof mechanism of spotting where there are errors. In my case, to make sure that there are no errors and everything sounds great, what I do is I play the four-part harmony into the sequencer, and then I play my chord sequence along with it and listen for any wrong tonalities. And we're going to do that in a minute. Let's just briefly analyze the next song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Now here I've taken the time to write over in the right hand side the notes of the various chords. So you can see that the D chord is D, F sharp, and A, as I said before, B minor is B, D, and F sharp. A is A, C sharp, and E. G is G, B, and D. And E is E, G sharp, and B. So when you look at the stacking, I haven't circled the stacking, you will see that in most cases, the chord that I've written above corresponds to the stack notes, except that once again, we have, and look at that where I've put the A seventh added to the G added to the A to make the A seventh there with the purple line. In this case now, we have the A in the bass, and we have a C sharp, but we have no E. So once again, we really should be playing an A seventh chord there because of the presence of the G. But once again, one of the notes from the A chord is actually missing. In the last example, it was the, I think that was the C sharp as well, but this one is missing the E. The last one was missing the C sharp, and this one is missing the E. So, as you can see, this is going to be a slightly more complex operation than you thought before. If it was really easy, everybody would be able to do it. It takes a little practice. It takes knowing your chords very well. It takes knowing being able to read your notes very well. And then it takes a certain amount of knowledge of harmony when they don't completely match up to a known chord. You can get that in a circumstance there. For example, in the one before that, we have an E and we have a D. As you can see there, we have the E and the D together, along with an A and a G bass. And I have rendered that as B minor, because B minor is the proper tonality in that particular spot. Now, another thing that you need to know is that where you have very, very short notes, where you have very, very short notes, like here, let me just get it to the here. Let's just make a note. Very, very short notes, they go by very, very fast. So they're passing notes. They're referred to as passing notes or passing tones. And you would not insert a different chord there, no matter what. It could not interfere with your harmony, because based on the length of time the note is held, it doesn't matter that much if the chord is not totally correct. But for example, where we have long held notes, let's change the color so that you can see. Where we have long held notes like a half note, and here we have a dotted quarter note, we really need to get the chords right, because those are being held for a long time, and if you're playing a wrong chord, everybody's going to know. Okay, so that's it. Now we're going to go to the keyboard, and we're going to let you hear it.